Mi nombre es Luisa Fuentes.
Mi nombre es María.
María.
Ana.
No, pues en realidad no tiene nada bueno, pues es la mayor parte nos toca pues sufrir la mujer, o no sufrir, sino que vivirlo y soportarlo. Pero pues en realidad hay muchas cosas que no son buenas.
Por ejemplo.
Por ejemplo, cuando te quieres desarrollar profesional no puedes en muchas ocasiones. Yo mi sueño era estudiar secundaria, preparatoria, llegar a una universidad, y no me dejaron por el machismo, que decían que no, que solo mis hermanos tenían el derecho de estudiar, de salir de la casa y estudiar. Y es por eso que nosotros tenemos una barrera, porque así nos educaron, así crecimos en mucho machismo.
Bueno, a mí me ha afectado en diferentes maneras. En mi forma de pensar, pues es que yo tengo muchas cosas que sentir acerca de eso. O sea, porque si la persona es machista, tú siempre vas a ser, puedes ser hasta violada, hacer cosas que tú no quieres hacer y tienes que hacerlas por obligación. Tienes que estar en tu casa siempre cuidando a tus hijos, tengas ganas o no tengas ganas de cuidarlos, tienes que, porque el hombre sale, trabaja, regresa y ya estuvo, se pone a ver televisión o pone a hacer cualquier cosa o tomarse su cerveza y ya completó su día. Pero la mujer, que es mujer de hogar, que vive con una persona así, tienes que ir a trabajar, regresar del trabajo, hacer la comida, atender a tus hijos, llevarlos a la escuela, traerlos de la escuela a ver que todo esté bien. Y es una rutina que tú agarras, pero la obligación no es nomás de la mujer, es del hombre, es de los dos.
Sí. ¿Cómo? Por ejemplo, si mi esposo, yo le comento voy a visitar a algún familiar y él no cree, y yo llego, o que él llegue a modo de que me quiera golpear. Si me golpea, yo también lo golpeo. Pero como no ha llegado a suceder eso, mejor hablamos. Yo le digo, si tú me quieres, debes de tener confianza en mí y yo tengo confianza en ti, para evitar los malos entendidos. O mejor no salgo yo a donde voy y él tampoco sale.
Bernice Zamora, 1938. Notes from a Chicana Co-ed, 1977. To cry that the gabacho is our oppressor is to shout in abstraction, carnal. He no more oppresses us than you do now, as you tell me. It's the gringo who oppresses you, babe. You cry, the gringo is our oppressor, to the tune of 20,000 to 30,000 a year. Brother, and I wake up alone each morning and ask, can I feed my children today? To make the day easier, I write poems about pájaros mariposas, and the fragrance of perfume I smell on your collar. You're quick to point out that I must write about social reality, about the gringo who oppresses you, babe. And so I write about how I woke up, I write about how I worked in beet fields as a child, about how I worked as a waitress 8 hours at night to get through high school, about working as a seamstress, typist, and file clerk to get through college, and about how in graduate school I held 2 jobs 7 days a week, still alone, still asking, can I feed my children today? To give meaning to my life, you make love to me in alleys, in backseats of borrowed Vegas, in $6 motel rooms, after which you talk about your 5 children and your wife who writes poems at home about pájaros mariposas, and the fragrance of perfume she smells on your collar. Then you tell me how you bear the brunt of the gringo's oppression for me, and how you would go to prison for me because the gringo is oppressing you, babe. And when I mentioned your GI Bill, your Ford Fellowship, your working wife, your three gabachas guisas, when you asked me to write your thesis, you're quick to shout, "Don't give me that woman's lip trip, mujer. That only divides us, and we have to work together for the movimiento. The gabacho is oppressing us." Oye, carnal, you may as well tell me that moon water cures constipation, that penguin soup prevents crudas, or that the Attic Ocean is menudo, because we both learn in the barrios, man, that pigeon shit slice easier. Still, because the gabacho, I must write poems about pájaros, mariposas, and the fragrance of oppressing perfume I smell somewhere. My marriage, I guess, had a lot to do with that. Is that just how everything just went down, how everything after he left, and still he, to this point, you know, kind of something still has a say of what I can and cannot do, of where I can and cannot go, and my children, because we have kids together. For example, when he hit my son, you know, to the point that he had bruises on his legs and everything, and we had a restraining order now. To make a long story short, he's able to see them, but I asked him if he can just keep him for a little bit longer, and he says, no, maybe you should have thought about that before you placed a restraining order. We had to go through all of this.
So he, in a way, is kind of controlling.
It's like, it's your fault, you know, because of you. But then I thought about it, and it's not me, it's him.
He's the one that...
Of course. If he would have thought about what he did before he touched my kids or my son, we wouldn't be doing this. But it's still kind of difficult to go through the whole thing of... I still kind of have to ask him or let him know where we're moving to, you know, if it's still okay in the area, kind of maybe, just because I can't leave the state without his permission, because he's still my kid's father. So.
So even still legally, you have to answer to him.
Right.